Hey guys, thanks for tuning in to another episode of Nuggets News. And today we've got a very special guest who's got an absolutely fascinating story. So welcome to the channel, Diddy.
Thank you for having me on your channel. And it's a pleasure, man. It's a pleasure. We were once in Australia. We loved it. So we love to share our story in Australia. And we will be there again in the next couple of years somewhere.
So in a nutshell, you really risked it all and put a lot of faith in Bitcoin. But for those that haven't followed your story, how did it come about, and what's your background?
You want the long version or the short?
Maybe the short version, and we'll get into some questions.
Okay. So the short version is that after 2016, in January, my father died after a year of disease and cancer, and I took care of him. But after this year, I realized life could go very fast. I already started mining Bitcoins and Dogecoins in 2013, but I need to stop attending to this because of the crash and because of taking care of my father. But then I started traveling because I had a burnout. And during the travels, I met a lot of people again who were talking about Bitcoin here, Bitcoin there. And I was like, no, man, not into Bitcoin at the moment. I've been there, done that. I lost faith because of the crash, of course.
Yes.
But then my friend who helped me with mining at 2013 called me and he was like, Diddy, are you still watching the market? I said, no, man, I'm enjoying a Bacardi Coke on the beach in Bali. I'm not watching or touching a laptop, man. And he was like, it's going up. It's starting. So that was the point in life. I quickly realized, wow, this monetary revolution is starting. You know, we are going to disrupt the monetary system. We are going to disrupt the banking system and everything. So I got this fire lighted in me again. And I was like, okay, now I need to check them. And I checked them and I saw the value going up of my millions of Dogecoins, you know, and I had a few Bitcoins left. So I thought, okay, now we need to change plan. So I walked up to my wife and I told her, what do you think if we go all in Bitcoin? We have been traveling for 9 months as a family. We are completely happy without any luxury stuff around us, just a few backpacks. And, you know, that was it. And she was like, yeah, you know, I like this travel style. I like that our kids are being educated into kids that are not just there accumulating wealth, but just being happy with living.
Yes.
So let's do it. So we flew home. I sold my house for Bitcoins. I sold my company. I took my pension. I took everything else. I took my motorcycles, my cars, and sold everything. My clothes, the kids' toys. And we went all in Bitcoin. And at that point, we were just like, okay, now we will go to a beach and I will zip some Bacardi Cokes and we'll wait till Bitcoin goes up to a million and just enjoy life. But exactly at that point, the media found out and we were bombed to the Bitcoin family.
Yeah.
And since, we have been traveling the world all over and educating people in the true fundamentals of Bitcoin and blockchain, speaking on conferences. I wrote a book which is being translated into English and German at the moment. And we just live the life of a Bitcoin family solely on crypto and very decentralized without owning shit. Just a few backpacks with clothes. Yeah.
There's so many great takeaways from your story, I guess. And as someone that also invested in Bitcoin very early on, it was never necessarily to get wealthy or to have lots of material possessions. It was more about being debt-free, financial freedom for my family. And I'd love to do what you're doing and travel the world. And I don't need a good car and a big house to be super happy. So is that kind of what you found?
Yeah, because, you know, from a young age, I started accumulating as much as possible euros to become a millionaire before I was 30, because that is the dream that is printed in your mind.
Yes.
Because of the schooling systems in the Netherlands. I think all over the world, you know, they are making us stupid, not smart. They're making us stupid. They think that the end goal in life is becoming a multimillionaire, and then you're happy because you have a big house and two cars and five other cars and another house. And, you know, this is not the end goal of life. This is not about life. This is a system they created. I call it the best multi-level marketing system ever existed.
Yes. And
to just let us believe in something which is not true. You know, life is about living. Life is about plucking an apple from a tree, eating it, enjoying time with your kids, not enjoying time, just enjoying time on work with the colleagues, you know.
Yes.
80 hours a week. No, you made kids. And that's, you know, what I think is very important that people need to understand.
Yeah, and I noticed on your Twitter feed, I think it says, you know, are we in the Matrix or, you know, in real life? And I guess I found myself, just to give you some background, I was a pharmacist and then I was practicing for about 5 years and I just found myself in the 9-to-5, you know, not really getting anywhere. And I was so passionate about Bitcoin and crypto. So I quit a couple of years ago to do this full time. And yeah, it's just that it is that matrix, isn't it? Why do you think it is, it the education system you touched on? Are people scared to take risks and get out of it? Or
no, you know, it's the educational system is not that old, you know, but it was the educational system was formed because of the capitalism market way of doing, you know. We didn't create the education system to educate people. No, we created the system, was created to create robots, you know, people that are able to do the same job day in, day out. That's why education is existing at the same time now. But because, you know, they needed all the same kind of labor people in the 50s.
Yeah.
And then education system should have evolved to this century of internet and of blockchain now and of cryptocurrency, but they did never do. You know, you can see all the motivational videos of Jay Shetty and all those guys on YouTube, and you see that the classroom hasn't changed for centuries. You know, yeah. Why do they? Why don't they just take a little bit, like, for example, yoga or meditation, or, you know, so that the kids learn the core values of being, you know, not just of the core values of accumulating wealth.
Yeah, I think a lot of people do find that. I know I did personally through meditation. I guess you become in touch with your inner self more, or the surroundings. Some people find that through taking psychedelics. So what sort of led your path down the rabbit hole in that regard?
I mean, I did everything. So I'm a very experiential guy. So I did meditation. I tried yoga, but my body is not equipped for yoga, I think.
Yeah.
I always played soccer, so I have like this stiff muscles and everything. So that's not a thing.
Yeah.
But if it comes to psychedelics, man, I did ayahuasca. I did all those things, you know, that just open up your mind and let you understand and see that there is way more in life than you're taught that there is.
Do you think that's changing? I know recently we've had a lot of great people like MAPS who receive a lot of Bitcoin donations. They're doing some studies with MDMA and psychedelics for health research. So do you think there's this resurgence of people, the next generation, that are far more open-minded to these topics?
Yeah, I think each generation in life changes. And I think we are now going into the emotional phase of the life stages, as we say it.
Yeah.
So I think the universe is changing this year, and I think slowly people are getting more awakened and understand, you know, that there is really more in life than just working or, you know, all the standard hamster wheel things they educated you to believe in. And with this awakening, I think, you know, and I, in my opinion, blockchain and Bitcoin are just two beautiful tools to create a bridge between this awakening and the monetary system all over the world.
Yeah.
Because we now can include the excluded, you know, and the excluded, we can say a lot about the excluded. They are excluded of the monetary system. But most of those people living in those regions that are excluded from the monetary system, they are included into this universal system of emotions. And I think they are more grounded, and they have the more spiritual and yoga things, so they are more, they stay more true to themselves.
Yeah.
So I think this will create an exchange, you know. They will teach us in the future how to become normal again, and we will teach them how to use Bitcoin, for example, to buy a nice book on eBay or whatever.
Yeah, and I think we're seeing a lot of the smartest minds sort of gravitate to that, rather than going to work for Google or Facebook. So it sort of becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy that things do change.
Yeah, I think it is. And I think we need to change.
I want to skip pace about living on Bitcoin. So do you have your ledger in your car? Or I'm sure you face plenty of issues with storing it or cashing out and spending in different countries. So without giving away too much of your secrets, how's that journey been? Yeah.
So that's the easy part for us, because we are all in. So we just spend Bitcoin, you know. We don't often exchange back. If we exchange back, we do it through, for example, Wirex. You know, this is a card that is Visa supported, and I can use it when there is no Bitcoin and accept them directly from stores.
Yes.
But I have a huge amount of trust in blockchain and Bitcoin. And so I don't want to have my ledgers with me at all. I don't need to have my ledgers with me at all. I don't need that money to live. So I think about 80%, 75, 80% of my holdings are just on a hardware wallet somewhere in the safe, somewhere in the world. I can't even touch them, you know? Yeah. Even if Bitcoin crashes to 3,000 a day, I'm not even able to touch them. Yeah. The other 20% I play with, you know, I trade, do some investments. So we earn Bitcoins by speaking, by doing the thing we do as a Bitcoin family. And we just live a very minimalistic lifestyle where we don't need a lot of money. So I don't need to touch those holdings. I think that was the secret of our change. You know, we could have go all in, but maintain the old fashioned lifestyle. But then my Bitcoins would have been gone in a year, you know?
Yes.
And because we switched to this minimalistic lifestyle and we travel to cheap countries and we sleep in cheap places, or we now have a camper van where we can sleep for free, because of reducing the monthly cost, I don't need to touch my hodl.
Yeah, it's certainly my dream to live off the grid down here in Tasmania, hopefully sooner rather than later. What other lessons have you learned, or the best experiences, or maybe some bad ones in your travels?
There's so many things, because if you live the practical life, so really living on cryptocurrency, you experience a lot of beautiful things, but also a lot of problems. But for example, we went to this beautiful city, and I've said this in many interviews, but in Italy, there is a small town. It's called Rovereto, and it's an Italian classical style town with beautiful churches and, you know, like European traditional style. And there are more than 60 shops in the town accepting direct payments of Bitcoin. You know, I could pay my groceries over there. I can buy clothes. I could even buy toys, my driving license. I could pay my taxes. I could pay my camping. I could pay my dentist. I could pay the doctor. I could pay the hairdresser, all directly with my Bitcoins.
Yeah.
And the thing what I find so beautiful and interesting is there was just one small company. It was small. It became big now. That was the motor behind this Bitcoin acceptance in this town.
Mm.
And then I thought, wow, if just one company can do this for a small classical town in Italy, then this can be done in every big town as well. You know, then Sydney can do it. If there is one motor driving this adoptance and driving and educating shops on how to accept Bitcoin, how to exchange Bitcoin to maybe, in their opinion, a store of value,
I was going to jump in, because I'm not sure when you came to Australia, but there is a little company called Travel by Bit who have now got about 300 merchants accepting directly, and basically with your cards that you mentioned before, you can spend Bitcoin anywhere else in Australia. So when were you in Australia?
That's now 3 years ago, but I'm looking forward to come back again, because we also, which is the airport again, which is like the Bitcoin airport of the world.
Brisbane Airport, and that's done by Travel by Bit guys. So I'm looking forward. I'll definitely come up and meet you when you come back to Australia. But any other lessons for people that are thinking of traveling on Bitcoin, or just must-do experiences?
You don't plan, you know. The only thing you can plan is to go to areas where you can see there are a lot of websites, you know, Bitcoin Radar and all those websites where you can see where there are more stores and restaurants accepting Bitcoin. And then you just travel to that area. So you can support the cryptocurrency community by spending your Bitcoins as well. So we just check, which towns accept Bitcoins? Is there a restaurant? Is there an accommodation I can pay with Bitcoins? Is there transportation I can pay? And is there some entertainment that I can use my Bitcoins for? So the town that comes near those four or five things, we just travel near there and we just try to expand as much as possible Bitcoins instead of other currencies.
Yeah, that's the message we're trying to get across to the government about tourism and that sort of thing as well. But I want to ask the volatility. So a lot of people would say, you're crazy not to sell at 20,000 and then buy again at 3. But I think hindsight is so 2020, isn't it? I mean, a lot of people sold too early, and I think taking that long-term view is always best for the majority of people.
For me, I think you're all right over there, but for me, it's different, because I experienced the first crash in 2014, and I got scared, and I needed to get out of the market, and I needed to sell my mining rigs to get even with my investment, blah, blah, blah. So I made that mistake once.
Yes.
I'm not going to make that mistake again. And again, for me, Bitcoin is a long-term investment. I think in 2-3 years time, Bitcoin will be above 100K. So, you know, if you believe that strongly in Bitcoin, even people always ask me, are you going to live this life forever? I don't know. I live day by day. But if I want to change my life in 5 years time, and I have 5 Bitcoins in 5 years time, and my Bitcoin's worth 200K at that point in 5 years time, I still have $1 million or euro if I want to change life and buy a house again. So we choose to live life day by day and just trust that Bitcoin will do the thing it's going to do. You know, and as long we believe this, we can live this life very easy without any stress of crashing Bitcoins, going up, going down. Bitcoin just crashed again, man. It went from 12K to almost 9K. Yeah. Maybe we'll go to 8K. Now, I'm not even, of course, I'm watching the market, but it doesn't influence me because I just need 2.5K a month to live with my family. And as long as I have this amount of money to live every month, we are happy. I enjoy waking up, seeing my family, seeing my kids every day. And this is the thing we focus on now. So I enjoy educating other people in this knowledge, in this Bitcoin, in this blockchain knowledge. The tour we are doing now is focusing on charities and poor people, the excluded, you know, because I've been to many conferences last year. Sorry, I always speak a lot, man.
No, that's all right.
but I saw on all those conferences that all the people that are able to pay like 300 euros, 200 euros for a ticket, they know everything already. You know, if I'm speaking on these conferences and I get a Q&A afterwards, they even ask like difficult questions,
yes,
which I even don't know the answer on.
Yeah.
So we are educating the wrong people on those conferences. So I decided this year, the next couple of years, we take this van and we drive all over the world to those areas where they are not able to pay money for those conferences and where we can educate those people that really need to be educated about Bitcoin and blockchain. So that's what we are doing now. Sorry.
Yeah, no, I got into Bitcoin in 2012, but it was pretty lonely, as you say. There wasn't a lot of friends or family even interested in it until 2017. And then we went on the road and we did free road shows around Australia in most of the capital cities. And I think I want to do that again when it starts to take off again. We did them all for free, as you say, because our target audience is the retail guy, the average guy on the street. And it's funny that Bitcoin technology has kind of been adopted more by those people. And they're waiting to get like Wall Street and ETFs and that sort of thing. The average guy's kind of got a leg up for the first time, I think.
Yeah, you know, people are still listening too much to all that FOMO news and all those things. That is, you know, I shared like a tweet yesterday about, I don't even remember the name of the guy who was talking now that he is afraid of Bitcoin, one of those millionaire investors of Shark Tank, you know, and he's afraid of Bitcoin and it's a scam.
Kevin O'Leary.
Yeah, that guy, man. In 2013, you know, he was discovered the video that he knows exactly what he's talking about.
Yeah.
People need to understand that those people play with your mind, just like they play with your mind in educating you on the wrong, you know, fundamentals of life. They are now educating you on the wrong fundamentals of blockchain and Bitcoin as well.
Yeah.
So don't listen to those guys. Just, you know, do your own research and understand that this thing is really going to change the world. If it goes up or down in value, it doesn't even matter. It's going to change the world. At the end, it will make you happy as an investor, I think. But it can also make you bankrupt. And then maybe you have lived a Bitcoin life for a few years. And, you know, you will see what you will do after this again.
Yeah. If Bitcoin went to zero tomorrow, what would you do, Diddy? Would you go back to your old career? What was that? Would you try something new?
I was an entrepreneur, so I had two companies and I had employees. I will never do that again because, man, you get like really, really, really like frustrated by having an own company with a lot of employees.
Tell me about it.
I don't know, man. If Bitcoin goes to zero, we are bankrupt. You know, we are bankrupt directly. So I don't. If it goes to zero, maybe I have like a few dollars left on my Wirex card to pay the gasoline back to the guy who sponsored the Bitcoin mobile. But then we will see. I don't even bother thinking about that because that's, in my opinion, not going to happen. And if it will happen, you know, I will worry about that then. The thing I'm seeing now is that Bitcoin is going up in the near future again. I think it will go down a little bit and will go up again because, you know, just watch the news. People in the government in New Zealand just declared Bitcoin a legal thing to pay salary.
Yes. Yeah.
Do you really think that if these things are happening all over the world, it's going to crash to zero?
Yeah, it was a little bit... I think that news was a little bit glorified because I know in Australia there's a company called Get Paid in Bitcoin that have been doing that for years and years. So I'm not sure it's in the law or whatnot, but you're right. And my next question was about the developing countries you've been through. Sometimes that gets overhyped as if everyone's turning to Bitcoin. Or have you seen it more in those countries or the awareness, or is it just the need in those countries more?
What do you mean? In the underdeveloped countries or the developed?
Yeah, in the underdeveloped countries, sorry. Yeah.
Of course, you know, for me, it's more easy to live in Thailand. People see Thailand as a third world country. Man, I can use my Bitcoin to Thailand for everything. I can pay my hotels. I can pay my Bacardi Coke in bars. I can do everything for Bitcoin in Thailand. Why? Because like 80% of the people in Thailand never made the step from cash money to card money like we did. No, we have our credit cards. We have our bank cards. We all have these things. 80% of the people in Thailand just lived on a cash life. You know, they get cash payments and they use the cash to pay again. For them, the step to digital cash is way more easy than for us because we believe that the banks are safe. We were taught that the banks are safe.
Yeah.
You know, we were taught that they will never touch your money. Read the small letters, man. It's not your money. The moment you put it on the bank, it's the bank's money. If they go bankrupt, your money is gone. And maybe you're insured to 100K, but that's all if you have more than, you know. So I think the step for those underdeveloped countries, it's more easy. Because, you know, look at China. They use WeChat to pay on markets, on streets, everything.
Yeah.
They already are digital. Look at Finland. All those countries are already digital. They don't use cash money anymore. The world is going to go cashless, like, in the near future, in my opinion. Why would you use cash? In 10 years' time, do you really think if you make a baby today and in 10 years' time, this kid really still thinks that uses cash? I don't think this. I think in 10 years' time, this kid will tell you, Daddy, did you really believe there was a value in paper? And if you paid this paper in a store, they didn't need to give you exchange. What is exchange?
Yeah.
You can pay with your telephone directly what you need to pay. This is the future. The future is not going to be paper or stones or shells again. It's going to be digital cash.
I had my first son 6 months ago, and I gave him a Bitcoin the day he was born. So I'm hoping that when he's 18, that's going to be a nice present for him.
I know it is.
Well, mate,
I believe it will.
This has been a fantastic chat. I'm definitely going to try and catch up when you come to Australia next. I'm jealous of the lifestyle. It's what I want to sort of live one day. So any final thoughts for people at home?
Yeah, don't be jealous on our lifestyle, because our lifestyle has its disadvantages. Also, the kids are kids. The kids are kids if you live in a house. The kids are also kids when you travel. They like it some days. They don't like it some days.
Yeah.
If I need to advise people at home, live life the way you want to live life. Don't run the hamster wheel because you think that's the only thing there is possible in life. You can change. I changed. I was the most materialistic guy you could ever meet. Running companies on top of the hill, drinking, you know, expensive bottles of Belvedere in clubs and all that stuff. I thought that would make my life more beautiful. It didn't make life beautiful at the end. If you lose people near you, then you realize that life is about more than just accumulating wealth. So stop accumulating wealth. Invest. Sell your second car. Sell your third car. Sell your motorcycle. Sell your motor home, for example. And just buy Bitcoins of this. You still have your first car and your house. And just believe that Bitcoin is going to go up and you really will have a pension. Because if you will believe in the government giving you a pension in 20 years' time, that money will be gone because of bad investments.
Yeah. I think that's a great place to
finish. And I'm not I'm not a financial advisor. Sorry.
That's all right. I think everyone knows. But I'll put the links to follow your journey down below, mate. And thanks so much for joining us today. It's been great.
Thank you for having me, and it was a pleasure, and keep doing what you do, man, and spreading the word, and a box on that one.
Will do. Cheers, guys.